Now that we have talked about how to set up equilibrium expressions, calculate equilibrium constants, both Kc and Kp, we start to discuss what those equilibrium constants are telling us. Once we get a value of Kc or Kp, it's important to know what that's telling us about a system. The equilibrium constant is telling us the extent to which a reaction will proceed at a particular temperature. Again, remember these are temperature dependent. And so really what an equilibrium constant is telling us when we get a K value, it's telling us whether we have more products or reactants in our system at equilibrium. So we have three possible scenarios. The first one is that a reaction will go essentially to completion, and the equilibrium mixture will consist predominantly of products. And if we think of our setup, again, we know that equilibrium constants are written as, or expressions are written as products over reactants. Realize that if I have more products in my container at equilibrium, I'm going to end up with a larger value. So one example of a reaction that is considered product favored is this one, the reaction of a silver ion with two ammonia molecules. This forms a new kind of substance called a complex ion. We won't study it in detail this semester, but it is a transition metal bonded to a small molecular ion. So notice it's still an ion overall. When we measure or calculate our Kc value, notice that we have an exponent of 10 to the 7th. That is a very large K value. That tells us that this system is product favored at equilibrium, meaning once this system no longer changes values, the molarities don't change anymore, I have a lot more of my products in the system. I'll still have some reactants in there. Again, equilibrium means that we still have a combination of products and reactants present, but my reactants are present in a very small amount. So, of course, the next scenario is the exact opposite. That if we have a reaction that doesn't occur to a significant degree or extent, the equilibrium mixture consists mostly of reactants. And so this is called reactant favored. A great example here would be the reaction between nitrogen and oxygen. These are, of course, both found in air, both very stable molecules. Since they're both very stable, there's no need for them to undergo a reaction to form nitrogen monoxide. And in fact, when we look at our Kc value, 10 to the minus 25, that is very, very, very small. And so this is a very reactant favored system. In fact, the smaller a Kc, the more reactant favored it is. The larger a Kc, the more product favored it is. So K values can cover the entire range of values. Our third scenario for a value of Kc would be if we had appreciable amounts of both reactants and products. So like this middle image here, where we have an intermediate between a small and a large K, realize in that case that our, sorry for all these extra things, I don't know what's going on here. There we go. Realize that because we're in between the small and the large, we call this intermediate. There's really no other definition to apply to it. And when we say that K is large, our typical cutoff for that is that K is going to be bigger than 1,000 or 10 to the third. When we say that K is small, we're meaning that K is, our cutoff for that is that K is less than 10 to the minus 3. So realize for all of these that K is relative to 1. Another way to phrase it is if I have a large K, I say it's greater than 1. If I have a small K, I say that it's less than 1, right? K is always going to be a positive value. So it's small, less than one, or large, greater than one. It can't be relative to zero. K can never be negative. So it could never be less than zero. On this slide, I'm just showing some relative values for equilibrium constants. Again, showing the temperature for these constants. These are not values you have to memorize. anytime you need an equilibrium constant, it's either going to be given, you can look it up in the textbook, or you're going to be given enough information to solve for it. So you do not need to memorize. These are just shown here to show you the range. And again, this is not the extreme, but just a selected group. So notice our largest one, most product favored here, is 10 to the positive 53. The smallest one here that we have is a negative 13. That is our most reactant favored. And again, this is definitely not the smallest. We have an example in chapter 15 where we'll see a minus 33 for our exponent. To make sure we know how to interpret small and large k values, we have a practice question here. In all of these, we're showing the same type of reaction, taking two diatomic elements, combining them together. What I want you to do is to determine which of these systems is showing the largest equilibrium constant and which one is showing the smallest and why. Pause the video to answer this question. When you have an answer, unpause it and we will finish this in our next slide. Okay, now that you have an answer, we want to determine which one is the largest equilibrium constant. Realize that largest means it has the most products in it. So in our first beaker, we only see two products. In our second beaker or container, we see a total of six products. And in this third one, we see a total of four. And so our second container, our one in the middle, would have the largest K value because it has the most products. And again, the one that has the smallest K value would be the most reactant favored. Another way to think about that is it has the least products. And so that would be our first or the left container here, has the smallest K value. The next type of practice problem we can work is building on that. Now that we're given a picture, we can use information in our first bullet up here to predict and calculate a Kp value. So we're told that we have a reaction that takes place between X2, these are the red diatomic molecules, and the Y2 are the blue, to form XY as our product. So our goal is to first predict a value or relative value of K based on whether we have more products or reactants in our container, and then to work through calculating the K value. So to predict it, notice that at a quick glance, when I look at this, I see slightly more products than reactants in here. And so I'm going to predict that my Kp is going to be a large-ish value. With any drawings, it's never going to be extreme, just so you know. But in order to finish this and to actually go through all of the steps, we need, first of all, to have a balanced chemical equation. So X2 and Y2 are where our reactants, XY is our product. To balance this, I need a 2 for my products. So we always start with a balanced chemical equation. Our second step then is to write our equilibrium expression for this. And then our third step would be to plug in quantities. So I'm going to go back to this slide. So I need to count each one. Again, XY is our product on top. So for XY, I have 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Yes, 12. So for my products, I have 12. And of course, that gets squared. For my reactants, for X2, which is my red, I have 1, 2, 3, and 4. For my Y2, I have 1, 2, 3, and 4 there as well. So plugging all of these numbers in, since I'm working with whole numbers and I'm counting molecules, I don't need to worry about sig figs here. On this one, we end up getting a whole number, and that is totally fine. But we don't worry about sig figs here because we are counting molecules. Counting molecules, we can't have partial fractions or decimals. And so 9 is our final answer. And realize that matches our prediction that K would be greater than 1. So this is a visual example of the steps we need to go through to calculate a K value.